Hi there. Thanks for tuning in on this recording that is discussing a training on Big IQ F5 Networks Partner Bootcamp Big IQ Fundamentals. This training is part of our channel Train the Trainer program, and I am for this session your trainer. My name is Michael Tornant, and I am working with F5 Worldwide Field Enablement. In this training, we are going to talk about Big IQ. Not a surprise. The training is consisting of two different parts. And the first part is more or less about the history and what Big IQ actually is. So all the way up to the questions that we're going to answer on why do you need Big IQ? What is the overview and what's the history where it comes from? What are the components and how does Big IQ look like when you try to manage it? All the way up till a hands-on lab exercise specifically for you. You will do the hands-on lab exercise so that you get familiar with Big IQ. In this first lab exercise, you will discover Big IPs, you will manage Big IPs, and you will do some changes and some backups of Big IPs through Big IQ. There is a second part. And also in this recording, that will be a separate second part that will focus much more on Big IQ as an application-centric management system. Meaning that next to the Big IPs that we're managing and the modules like LTM, ASM, APM, and all the others that we are managing through and with Big IQ, we now also have the application-centric approach where all audience in your organization gets Big IQ as a tool to do their specific activities, whether you are working within NetOps, SecOps, DevOps, or are an application manager. Big IQ will provide you with that particular part of the tool set that you need to stay in control of your application and the application services guarding it. So let's dive in to the first question that needs to be answered, and that's the why question. Why do we need Big IQ? What is driving the need for centralized device management? Every year, F5 conducts several studies around application services. So then we are looking at delivery, security, and all the assets around it. And that data is now used in this presentation, as well as data from a third independent survey that's being done by IT Pros. What you're seeing is that 38% of the thousands of people that responded mentioned that they don't have confidence in the ability to keep track of their applications. And hey, you know, if you can't track the application, how can you effectively troubleshoot it when there are issues or problems? That same number of respondents, 26% of them, consider visibility as their largest challenge when you're looking at multi-cloud environments. Visibility closely tied to performance and security as other challenges. 87% of those customers already operate in multiple cloud environments, and that creates a sprawl in operating environments. And of course, that is done because of a strategic advantage, because from a business perspective, looking at cost, uptime, speed to market, that multi-cloud is feeding it. But the lack of confidence in their ability to track all their apps is still very, very present. If you add this up, then strangely enough, that third driver, the 87%, is related to the digital transformation and the rat race that comes with it. We are increasing the problem of control and visibility. And that's exactly what everybody admits. 99% of the respondents have said that visibility and control are currently elusive goals for their organization. So it is clear that customers need effective management, and that can be achieved by getting visibility. So the increasing lack of visibility, don't get us wrong, that is not stopping innovation within the companies. They will continue their digital transformation journey, because if they want to survive, they need to excel their competition, or that digital transformation will at least make sure that they stay in the boat. So 69% of all these companies indicate that they are executing digital transformation. 60% of the enterprises that have cloud visibility, and one step back, that is a small group, because we just saw that the majority has a concern on visibility. So from that small group of enterprises that have visibility, 60% of them claim, and this is from a Gartner report, they claim that because of their visibility and the monitoring tools that they are using, they have 1/3 less security failures. And we don't have to explain to you that 1/3 less of security failures means a whole lot of additional uptime, income, availability, and all those other things. Still, that challenge is there, because none of them, none of the interviewed, can accurately report the number of applications that they have in their portfolio. So, what are the most pressing multi-cloud management challenges that must be addressed to succeed with that transformation? 55% says IT optimization is needed. And another big group, 51%, claims that consistency and visibility with a single pane of glass in the sprawl will help. 49% of the companies find improving the applications to be their most difficult challenge within multi-cloud operation. So, how to enhance the applications and how to optimize the user experience? When businesses and IT need to be aligned, and that's currently what they need to be to have that successful digital transformation implementation. In the app-centric world that we are in, as said, apps are currently the crown jewels and the core business of companies. You need to be assured that you have consistency, reliability, manageability, deployment and velocity of all your app services at any time. Ask yourself, do you have visibility within health of your devices, of your app services, of your encrypted data, the traffic that is floating through your network? Have you got a good overall view of the security posture and the health situation of your applications? And lastly, are your developers, your SecOps and your NetOps teams and your application managers, are they all equipped with the proper tools to take responsibility for the activities that we all expect them to do, to make sure that the app services and the underlying infrastructure are optimized, available, and secure? Big IQ, with centralized management, with the app-centric approach, will help organizations to address all of these challenges. Big IQ, what is it? And is it finished? No, because we will keep creating new demands. So So BigIQ will add new features to address those demands. And that journey is ongoing, and that journey has started, and that journey has been very, very thrilling up till now, so far. So let's look at where it all started. It did all start with Enterprise Manager. Enterprise Manager was F5's first element manager. It was replaced by BigIQ somewhere in 2014, and the first version was version 4.0. And what you see on this slide is that we have added features and we have fixed issues down the line and through all the releases that we have brought out. The earlier releases were focusing on BigIP development management, and we added more and more ADC features and functionalities. So LTM was added in version 4.4, and we added APM and ASM and other modules, like most recently in version 7.1, we also included SSL Orchestrator as a module that can be managed through BigIQ. 7.1 and also the earlier release 7.0 bring also more features and more functionalities, and this all started with version 6.0. So over the last 2 years, we more and more focused on the needs from the consumers of the application services. So our traditional users are still out there and will use BigIQ, but more and more BigIQ is used by the application owners and the DevOps teams, and they now have automation options, APIs, AS3 that has been added. They have a beautiful dashboard with analytics that provides them information for the whole user group. We have added analytics, HTTP analytics, TCP analytics, RBAC to make sure that all those different users has been introduced and release by release enhanced and enhanced up to a level where it doesn't really matter what you are doing. If you are doing something with application services that are running and using big IPs, you want to have your part of the view through BigIQ. So that central device management is, of course, where it all started with. And we also do certificate management. Always interesting, the HTTPS SSL certificates that now can be managed centrally instead of doing it manually on all the different big IPs. That is a huge relief. Big IP license management, all the same. Role-based access, we already discussed. And of course, you can create backups from big IPs and you can restore configurations from big IPs. That's why it is an element manager. Like I also said, that role-based access has been enhanced up to a level where also DevOps and the application owners can fully utilize BigIP to get out of it what they need. And what they need is very often automation. And that's what we're supporting. We've introduced AS3. They have self-serviced app services that they can spin up whenever they need. They have a visibility through the analytics and the dashboard on a per app level for if there are multiple application owners. They have their own view and their own preferences, because they have their own needs and their own habits and their own drivers. So that's why we believe that we are now able to address the needs of all these BigIQ consumers, as it supports both our traditional NetOps and SecOps customers, but also the new consumers, whether they are application managers or DevOps engineers in their teams. BigIQ is there for them. Centralized benefits, app-centric visibility, GUI or API driven, depending on where you come from and where you stand. We will also, and that is pretty interesting, support brownfield applications. So an application that has been created on a big IP can now also be included in the dashboard analytics, as so that you can do your troubleshooting and your health specifications. Right, we have now seen why we need a centralized element manager like BigIQ, and also what BigIQ is and what it exactly brings and solves with the challenges that organizations are facing today. Now let's take a deeper look at the BigIQ components and their architecture options. So let's dive in and see how all those things fit together. The BigIQ components consists of two elements. We are looking at console managers, and we are looking at DCDs, data collector devices. And within the green dotted area, you see a particular operational environment where we have two control managers forming the console in a high available situation, and they are supported with several DCD devices. And a BigIQ data collection device does exactly what the name says. It collects and it aggregates health and performance statistics. It is simply a log server. Everything you want to log, you can log towards the DCD. And they are, besides that, also used to collect any learning suggestions that you might have for the central policy builder. The BigIQ console is the central manager that provides you with your administration. That's where you do all the configuration and all the other big IP controls, all the per app visibility dashboard features are happening in this area. From version 7.0, we have that active failover where we are working with the requirement of a layer 2 broadcast domain in between the two CMs, a floating IP address that is owned by either the active and will be taken over by the standby if something happens with the active CM device. To avoid any split brain scenarios, there is one DCD that can be used as a quorum or a tiebreaker in case we are looking at two CM devices that consider themselves as the active one. The minimum architecture that you need can be one CM and one DCD, but then you are looking at a lab environment or a demo environment like the one that we are using in this course. In an operational environment, we recommend to have a high available solution with at least two CMs and three DCD devices. Yeah, the BigIQ CM, the central manager, as the name says, it's there to manage the big IP configuration objects. It manages the modules LTM, DNS, AFM, ASM, APM, and since recently, SSL orchestrator, all done through one console. It does deliver analytics, visibility, reporting, and it does manage all big IPs, no matter whether they are appliance big IPs, so if we are looking at iSeries or Vipriens or virtual editions, they can all be managed by BigIQ. Automation is important, so big IP configurations can be managed and pushed from BigIQ to big IPs using declarative APIs. Role-based access control, I think we have discussed and talked about that enough. You will see more on this topic in the labs yourself. One other thing worthwhile knowing is that BigIQ is a license manager. If you use it as a license manager only, it is for free and then it can handle the licensing for up to 5,000 unmanaged devices. Also worthwhile mentioning is that F5 BigIQ moved from using a Tokamak to a Postgres database from version 7.1. If you upgrade your BigIQ, be aware because that could affect the settings of your other devices, because Postgres is using a different TCP socket, TCP port 5432, where Tokamak was using 27017. So be aware, if certain things aren't working anymore after the upgrade, you might need to look at that. Also, BigIQ needs two interface cards that will be solved in future releases, but for now, realize and be aware, BigIQ CM requires two interfaces. You don't have to use both of your interface cards, but you need two of them. So you can stack out-of-band management and in-band management, but if you have the option, we recommend you to use out-of-band and in-band management, particularly also because auto failover is only supported on the out-of-band management interface. So the floating IP address can only run on that particular interface. So next to the CM, let's look at the DCD, the data collector device. What you now see is a screen dump from BigIQ in a DCD environment. You already see the six tab environments where all the management is being done, and underneath system, everything related to BigIQ is handled. So the BigIQ CM, the BigIQ DCD, and this is the data collection device that we are looking at. If you are using DCDs, and you are, it is required to have AVR analytics activated on your BigIPs. So the DCD collects alerts, events, statistics. It enables the BigIQ CM to provide the central analytic dashboards and the per application visibility. It can act, and we recommend that you should use it to act as a quorum device. So it will be that tiebreaker in case of two active CMs. And new in version 7.1 is that the BigIQ licenses are no longer required for the DCD devices. Sizing and scaling. Currently, there is a support up to 1200 BigIP devices, 500 BigIP stats that can be collected, 400,000 objects, and 1000 ASM policies spread over 160 BigIP devices. So there is considerable scalability possible. Nevertheless, we do recommend you to always check Ask F5, spend your time designing your BigIQ environment, and if needed, use F5 support, because sizing is important, and if you haven't sized properly, that can be pretty painful if you need to upgrade later on. So spend some time, use our documents, and understand what type of TMOS versions need to be supported in your environment and what the implications are. F5 BigIQ sizing tools should always be used. When sizing, also remember that we have two types of BigIQ VE images. There is a large image and there is a standard image. And the difference in both is the disk space that they have available. The large image, that will be recognized by the L, has a disk space of 500 gigabyte, where standard has 95 gigabyte disk space available. And we recommend to use the large image for DCD and CM. License manager fits in standard. CM fits in both. Where possible, use large, particularly in big and in high available deployments. If your organization runs globally, be aware that all your BigIQ CMs, DCDs, and the big IPs that are being managed should be within approximately 75 milliseconds latency of each other. That means if you are a global organization, you might need to introduce regional management so that you have addressed this concern. Good that you're still connected. We are at the last section of this first part of the Big IQ course. So, like explained in the introduction, it's a course that can fill one day and it contains of two parts, and we are now at the last section of the first part. This section is about the Big IQ user interface, the GUI. And you will see a couple of screenshots of important areas within the Big IQ user interface. This chapter is mainly here to make you feel comfortable for the lab exercises that will follow afterwards. Big IQ, the GUI. Very important is that you understand that there are six different areas, six different sections, or as in Excel very often explained, different top environments. And those areas are system, where you can configure and monitor and manage everything related to the Big IQ itself. There is a section on devices, and within the devices you will find your Big IP elements. There is a section configuration, so if you want to change something within LTM, adding a node, creating a virtual server, or maybe in ASM security policy, that's done in the configuration area. Once you have created your configuration, you want to deploy your change, and that's done in the section of the deployment area. Monitoring, great for troubleshooting if you want to find out what's happening with the traffic flow and if everything is working okay. And next to monitoring, there's the application area, where you will also find the dashboard and the analytics and a option to create and change the applications, the virtual servers. So the system environment, the Big IQ environment, that's the device. In this particular case, we are looking at a CM, and within that area you will see that it needs to have self IPs and VLANs configured. It needs to have a name and all those things for you to be able to communicate with the Big IPs. So yes, always handy that DNS and network time protocol are set up. So what you see here are the initial setup statements for a Big IQ system. Big IQ, of course, also requires backups. So if anything happens, you're always able to restore and continue working with your Big IQ system. So the Big IQ system backup can be found under systems, where the top of the GUI, and the GUI is accessed with any browser that you can use, you will find status information on your Big IQ, whether it's up and running, green, and any other color probably means that there is an issue that you want to check into. The status of it up and running, is it standalone, is it high available, what's the name of the Big IQ system, what's the IP address, the management IP address, and there is a timestamp. So there is a lot of information also on top of your browser, on top of your user interface. If you're running a backup, you need to make sure that the backup can be identified uniquely with a name. You can also schedule backups if you want to, so that you don't forget it, what can be a risk in a manual process. Once we have investigated everything under the system area, we're going to do a deep dive on the devices. And the devices, as said earlier, are the Big IPs. And within that area, there are a lot of options that can be configured that are all Big IP related, from the onboarding towards the clustering and the groups and everything you can see here. But before that happens, you need to make sure that a device is added. So Big IQ is aware of the Big IP device. And that's being done with add devices. Specify the information of the device and establish a trust with your Big IP device. Once that trust is established, you will need to specify the services that this particular Big IP is using. The example that you're seeing here, it is only using the LTM module and the LTM features and functionalities next to the CPU and status monitoring. Once a Big IP is discovered, it needs to be imported into the Big IQ, and that's being done by a double click on this particular status, complete import tasks. If you have changed your Big IP, because you will need to import, as we said on the earlier slide, but if you have changed your Big IP, and we strongly advise you not to if you have Big IQs, use Big IQ, your management system, as the single source of truth. If you start making changes on Big IPs and managing them by Big IQs, then you will have mismatches in your configuration. If that occurs, then you can still fix it with that rediscover button, because with the rediscover button, the configuration of the Big IP, or at least that's an option that you're having, that configuration can then be downloaded, and you have the option to decide which of the configurations will be the configuration that you're going to continue with. So the one running on the Big IP, or the one that you have stored and saved on the Big IQ. Like Big IQ has the status information, also Big IP has the status information. When accessed through its GUI, you can see in the left top corner of your Big IP what the status is. In this particular case, this is a Big IP called Big IP A. With this IP address, it is online and active. It acts as a standalone device, and what it's all about, this device is under management of the Big IQ environment. Like Big IQ can be backupped, the Big IP devices can also be backupped. And also here, the backups can be scheduled if you prefer to and don't want to forget. Once you have created your backup, you can, from the same area, restore the backup when needed. And again, also for Big IPs, backups need to be specified with a name before you can start the backup task. The configuration section, so we have now discussed system and devices. The configuration section has all the configuration statements on LTM, on APM, on AFM, on the different F5 Big IP modules. So if you want to add, change, or activate that functionality, that's being done under the configuration area. If you have created that configuration, you will deploy and activate your change under this section. The monitoring section, as you will see in the lab exercise, will give you a lot of information on the status of not only the Big IQ, but also the Big IPs and the application services managed and running on the Big IPs. Those application services and applications are then configured, changed through the applications area. Your analytics dashboard is also to be found under the application area. For now, these are the screenshots that we want to share. And it is more than time to tell you a little bit about the lab exercise that we are going to do right now or after a small break. Hey, this is a lab environment with two exercises. It will take you roughly, and maybe some people a little bit quicker and some people take a little bit longer, but you can estimate that it takes you an hour to learn how to discover Big IP devices, how you can create a Big IP and Big IQ backup files, and how to restore a Big IP backup file. You will explore all other options within the Big IQ. You will create your virtual server and your pool and your nodes so that it is actually confirming to you that this can be done this way and it works using role-based access, because yes, there are different roles and user groups and users that you can completely fine-tune up to the needs of an organization. Enjoy the lab. If you have an issue, make sure to check in with your trainer who will help you solve the issue or the question. And with that said, this is the end of the first part of the Big IQ Foundation course.